some parts will be sped up really fast, and if you have any questions, feel free to just raise your hand or stop me. I'll just kind of keep going, and then you can write questions down, we can answer some stuff at the end. My name is Jennifer Thomas, I'm a physical therapist. I work for Randolph Hospital System with Deep River Rehab. It's an outpatient clinic in Randleman. We also have several locations in Randolph County, but my office is in Randleman. I am also a credentialed clinical instructor, so I do have students that come and do their clinical internships with me. I'm also the CCCE, so I basically place everybody in our clinics. My most recent certification was in vestibular rehab in April of this year. I went to Emory University and did a week-long intensive certification course that I thought I would never make it. I felt like I was back in college again. And so I got my certificate in vestibular rehab from the ABTA and Emory University. So my favorite subject is vestibular rehab. I am now building a vestibular rehab program within our hospital system or more our outpatient offices. And so we have one other therapist that treats vestibular patients and then me. So within Randolph County, there's only two of us that actually will treat vestibular rehab. So we'll start with a little quiz. Wake y'all up. Name the parts. All right, what's number one?
Semicircular canal.
Okay, which one? It's hard to see it on there, but it's the anterior. That's the anterior. Number two?
Posterior.
It's the posterior. Number three?
Horizontal.
Good. Number four? Anybody know what number four is? That means the quad. This right here. There's one on each canal. Right here. These are called the ampullas. And that's where the hair cells are. And we'll get to that. Okay. Number five? Yeah. Number five? Right here. That's the utricle. And number six, just the little banana shaped thing, that's the saccule. Okay, so those are the important areas that you need to know about vestibular rehab. Okay, this part over here, what is this? Do I know what that is? They are located at right angles to each other and are filled with fluid called the endolymph. Okay, so the endolymph basically floats around in all of those semicircular canals. So when the head rotates in the direction sensed by the canal, the endolymph fluid within the within it lags behind because of inertia and exerts pressure against the canal's sensory receptors. The receptor then sends impulses to the brain about movement. When your vestibular organs on both sides are functioning properly, because you have one in each ear, right? They send symmetrical impulses to the brain, and the impulses originating from the right side are consistent with the impulses originating from the left side. So that's very important to know. We're going to talk about diagnosis in a minute. So when your vestibular system on both sides is doing what it's supposed to do, it's going to tell you where you are in space, no matter where you turn. Okay? Some will be efferent, some will be afferent. So basically, some will shut off when you do a certain thing, some send impulses to shut off, and then some will actually send impulses to turn on. So you know what your eyes and your body's doing in space. Okay, so this is what happens when, has anybody sat on a stool and spun around, 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 around? Okay, so the first couple times you spin and you stop, what happens? You get dizzy, right? Okay, so what if I was just to sit here and spin you for a minute? Same speed, same velocity, nothing's changing. What do you think will happen?
You'll
throw up. Do what?
You'll throw up.
Your body actually gets used to it. And then when you stop, then you realize, oh, I'm dizzy, I'm not supposed to be doing that, okay? So this is what happens. When you're at rest, the endolymph is just sitting still. When you start to spin or exhale, the endolymph actually gets swooshed one way. And it deflects this little thing called the cupola, which is right here. And this is where your sensory information is. So you're actually going to feel like you're dizzy. But then when you're at a constant angular motion, so if you're just constantly spinning, okay, you actually get used to it because the endolymph equals the amount the cupola is, and it doesn't really deflect it. It just stays equal. But then when you stop, the endolymph's still going, but you're stopped, so then it deflects the cupola opposite way, and basically you perceive that you're dizzy, okay? So I got two great examples of this, and I'll show you. And this doesn't have sound, but this will tell you exactly how your vestibular system works. Anybody ever play the Dizzy Bat Race game? Watch these guys. Basically firing impulses to our brain, okay? Now, with a rotational chair test, this is a test that they use in, this one has sound. It may not play. But you can just watch it. She's gonna tell you about it. She's an audiologist. They actually have this kind of chair in their office to do testing with. And
is it why you not look on that?
Step, and then spin in a complete circle for about 45 seconds in the other direction.
So this
and then
machine actually
the purpose of the test is to look at how well the balance center is working.
At the same
this
rate.
Test is generally done in individuals who cannot have the caloric test done, or who don't tolerate the caloric test, or for young children.
So they're basically testing right there a certain reflex that your brain has, but they can also spin it at equal velocity. And they actually look at the eyes because your eyes tell you a lot about what's going on in your vestibular system. We'll also get to that. So with your vestibular system, your cupola is in the semicircular canals and the macula is in the otolith organs. Okay, so let me see. All right, this is the macula, okay? And this is the cupola. So all these little things right here are hair cells, okay? With pinocilia and sterocilia. And they detect what's going on in your inner ear, okay? So if this little bubble here is shifted one way, it's going to tell the brain something. If it shifted this way, it's going to tell the brain something, okay? So they all send signals back. They are connected to the nerves. So they all send signals back to your brain telling you what's going on in your inner ear and vestibular system. Now, these here are important. So these are little otoconia. And how many of y'all have heard of BPPV or positional vertigo?
Oh.
Okay. So these are the little crystals. When people say you got rocks loose in your head, these are the little crystals that get out of the saccule and utricle, and they actually get over here in these canals. And we'll talk about that, how to treat that as well. Okay? So like I said, when that little cupola, that little bubble gets deflected, when there's a distortion of the cupola that evokes a receptor in the hair cells that alters the level of activity of the fibers in the nerve innervating the hair cells, and that's where your dizziness comes from. So basically, when that cupola gets deflected and those hair cells move a certain way, it sends signals to your brain to tell you that you're dizzy. Okay, and these are what hair cells look like microscopically. So the stereocilia move towards the kinocilia. The kinocilia is like the big daddy, the chief. So it's the biggest one, the tallest one. And so when it deflects towards, when the other little ones deflect towards it, then it depolarizes. And that's going to basically do an excitatory signal through your vestibular nerve. If it moves away from it, then it decreases the excitatory rate going to your nerve. And this is what I said, the utricle and saccule, they're sitting right on top, and then the little otoconia crystals are sitting there. And this is like a gelatinous material, this blue stuff right here. And basically the otoconia are supposed to stick to this gelatinous material, but as people age, this doesn't get, it loses its stickiness. They're not as nutritious anymore. It's kind of dehydrated. So that's where those crystals start to slough off, and they'll move throughout the vestibular system and get into the inner ear canals. Okay, so there's two arteries that supply the labyrinth thing. There's the anterior vestibular artery, and it supplies the anterior semicircular canal, the horizontal semicircular canal, and the utricle. It is actually the most common artery to have an infarct. Y'all see that artery? Yep. So you can actually have an infarct in that artery and it will shut down all three of those systems, the anterior canal, the horizontal canal, and the utricle. The posterior vestibular artery supplies the posterior semicircular canal and the saccule. And then you have nerve supply. You have the superior vestibular nerve, the inferior vestibular nerve. So there's the branches of that. You have here the superior vestibular ganglion coming down off the vestibular cochlear nerve. It supplies the anterior horizontal and saccule, utricle, and then the inferior is the posterior canal and the saccule. Now that's important to know between the blood supply and the nerve, because if you have nerve damage to the superior vestibular ganglion, what's not going to work? Your anterior canal, your horizontal canal, and your saccule, okay? If you have damage to your inferior nerve, what's not going to work?
Posterior and saccule.
Mm-hmm. Utricle.
Utricle.
No, posterior and saccule, yeah. Utricle is the other one. Superior. So that's going to be important, because you may have a patient that comes in that's diagnosed with the unilateral vestibular hypofunction. You're like, what is that? But basically, they have a part of their system has been shut down either by an infarct or by a damage to the nerve, a virus that attacks the nerve. And this is very common. It's called vestibular neuritis, okay? So vestibular neuritis is a viral inflammation of the nerves that commonly affects the superior vestibular nerve, which causes loss of nerve input to the anterior canal, horizontal canal, and the uterine. So more than likely, if they come in and they have a hypofunction, it is probably from a virus or an infarct that has attacked the blood vessel or the nerve. They don't have no rhyme or reason why this occurs. They just think it's an insidious thing that happens. They've seen it a lot with somebody that may have had ototoxic medication, like gentamicin or something like IV, you know, they've had IV antibiotics. That increases the risk for the viral inflammation. And then also, like, I've even had patients that have had some type of strep throat or some kind of virus within their body that has attacked their inner ear as well. So they really don't have a lot of research now saying this is what causes the neuritis. They're just basically saying that it could be this or it could be that. These are the central predictions. Have y'all had neuro yet? Okay. So this is the stuff that I'm like, oh, because I'm an outpatient PT, so I don't do a lot of neuro. But what happens is when you have a three-neuron reflex arc. So basically, from your inner ear, it's going to travel through the vestibular nucleus, through the abducens nucleus, to the eye, to the oculomotor nucleus, to the eye. Okay, so there's a three-neuron reflex. So basically, when you're staring at something and you turn your head, I can still stay focused on that object. That's your VOR reflex, okay? So if I'm looking and I turn and my eyes cannot stay focused, there is some kind of damage to my pathway through one of those reflexes that tells me that I can't stay focused on what I need to focus, and my VOR is impaired, okay? So, you have inhibitory pathways and you have excitatory pathways. The red is excitatory. So basically, when I turn my head, this lateral rectus has to work, and then this medial rectus has to work, right? And then it shuts off on this side. So that way I can maintain focus on what I'm doing. So you have to have all of those reflexes intact for your eyes to do what they're supposed to do. When they're not, you'll also see nystagmus, talk about in a little bit too, where the eyes are jumping like this and they're bouncing too, okay, because there's some kind of reading that's not telling the brain signal that's getting sent to the brain telling it what it needs to do. And there's just some more of your eye muscles. If you look down, which is your anterior canal, it excites the ipsilateral and superior rectus and contralateral inferior oblique, and it inhibits the other ones opposite of that to get your eyes to move up with some left torsion. Okay, so there's even a torsional component to that. All right, nystagmus. Involuntary rhythmic movement of the eyes. We call it jerking of the eyes. Has anybody ever seen nystagmus? You have? Okay. Have you seen it when they're actually looking a certain way, or have you just seen it staring at them in their eyes? Of the hair cells in the ampulla of the canal are persistent. So that's when we were talking about the ampulla is that little bubble at the end of the canals. That's where the hair cells are. So if there's constant stimulation of that ampulla and those hair cells, you're going to get the jerking of the eye because it's following that neuron path. It always beats towards the side of increased neural activity. Remember that, because you may look at somebody and when they look left, their eyes jump, or right, their eyes jump. When they look left, it doesn't jump. So possibly a left-sided hypofunction because you're not seeing any nystagmus over here because it's going to be towards the side of excitation, okay? Results from lesions of the vestibular system, including peripheral central connections of the brainstem and cerebellum, can cause nystagmus. Also, nystagmus can also visual impairment and from toxic substances. So this is one reason police officers use the light to look at people's eyes when they're pulling someone over. Did you know that? This is the cool fact that I learned in my class. So apparently alcohol can actually perfuse through the vestibular system and cause nystagmus. So the concentration of the alcohol versus the indolent fluid that's in your inner ear can cause nystagmus. So if there's somebody that's really intoxicated and they pull them over and they shine the light in their eyes, they're not doing it basically to see if they're awake. They're looking for nystagmus. Because if they are highly intoxicated, they will have nystagmus. They also, don't do this party trick now, but most of the time when highly intoxicated people lay down really fast or sit up really fast, they also almost like they have the spins is what they call them. You know, they're like, oh my God, you know. And that's also because of the alcohol level, the perfusion into the vestibular system. So I just thought that was a crazy fact. Let's see if these things work. Okay, here's nystagmus, and this is using goggles. So it's just an involuntary jerking of the eye.
Torsional component to it.
Whereas the last one, see that one? It has no torsion, it's just horizontal. It's straight beating horizontal. Okay? Now, the torsional one, you will see in BPPV. Okay? So any patient that has peripheral vestibular dysfunction, which is positional vertigo, you're going to see a torsional component, okay? It can be up or it can be down, okay? If you see a horizontal component, that's going to be either the horizontal canal, because it's straight horizontal, or that's going to be a hypofunction of one not working like the other side. Okay. Some people do. Some people will say, my eyes are jumping again, aren't they? They can actually feel their eyeball move in its socket. Okay, because it's not just, it's the whole eyeball. It's bouncing. So, how many of y'all have had patients that you've seen on your clinicals that say that they're dizzy? And you're not treating for that. They just say, oh, I get dizzy. Or I have dizziness, or I wake up. Get out of bed and I'm dizzy. Most people have seen, you know, people just in the supermarket they get up too fast or they move too fast and they have to grab a hold of something. Okay? So dizziness is really a non-specific term. So as PT assistants, because y'all can't really diagnose, I'm going to give you some questions to ask your patients, because you're going to be treating a total knee replacement and they're going to, in conversation, tell you, you know, when I get up out of bed at night to go use the bathroom, like I have to stand there for a minute because, you know, I'm really, really dizzy. So vertigo is any sensation of movement when it's not occurring. Unsteadiness is general or actual ataxia or possibly falls. Anything that is not vertigo or unsteadiness is kind of classified as dizziness. So that could be lightheadedness, disorientation, feeling funny. I've had patients say that. So it's important that you ask them to describe what they are feeling. So here's the questions you need to ask them as PT assistants. How long does it last? Does it last seconds? Does it last minutes? Hours? Is it continuous all the time? Does it go away and then come back? And how do they describe it? Go ahead and ask them, like, well, is it, how would you describe the dizziness that you're having? Is it the room spinning, or is it just like you're unsteady when you're up walking? And then what brings it on? Some people will tell you, they'll just give it away. When I roll over in bed on my left side, the room starts spinning. If they tell you that, that is more than likely positional vertigo, because they're telling you the ear. It's the left ear, and it's when I roll. And then a lot of women will say, when I go get my hair done and they lay me down to wash my head, like that whole motion, that's posterior canal. So I just get the room start spinning and I have to sit there a minute for it to go away. So positional vertigo is very like position, like it's based on position and it's very brief. It usually doesn't last more than a minute, okay? And then do you have any hearing issues like ringing in the ears, like feeling like your ears need to pop, or recent hearing loss? So your patient that we were talking about that couldn't hear, like your question would be, is this something recent, like that just happened in the last month or so, or have you always been like this for like years? Because if it's recent hearing loss, then it could actually be something regarding the cochlea too, being something damaged in that vestibular cochlear nerve that's causing their cochlea to not work, plus their vestibular system. So that can even be up into the brainstem and central, which we're going to talk about. Okay, so how many of these diagnoses do you recognize? Have y'all seen these before? BPPV, TMJ, you know what TMJ is? Okay. Neck pain, migraines, cervicalgia, neck pain, abnormality of gait, to have ataxic gait, dizziness and giddiness, Meniere's disease, there's a lot of people out there with Meniere's disease, stroke, somebody that's had a stroke. TMJ can cause ear ringing. So if you have a patient that comes in that has a little bit of dizziness complaints and they also complain of tinnitus, that could also be a TMJ dysfunction. So you can kind of say, hey, does your jaw hurt when you eat? Or, you know, are you, you know, kind of feel that TMJ joint and see what it's doing. And then when it's just peripheral vertigo, that just means it's outside of the brainstem. All right, so here's some causes of vestibular dysfunction. Viral. What I was talking about, that neuritis. Treating the symptoms of the virus is basically what they're going to do for the patient. If it's acute, it lasts less than 3 days. If it's chronic, it's more than 3 days. It can be just one ear, or it can be both ears. So you can actually have virus attack both ears, which is not fine for the patient whatsoever because they lose both systems. So their balance is absolutely horrible. Headaches and migraines can cause vertigo, vestibular dysfunction. Strokes, central lesions like MS, Parkinson's, cerebellar disease can also cause dizziness and vertigo. TBIs, which we'll talk about that in a minute too, because a person with concussion will have symptoms of dizziness, blurred vision, possible ringing in their ears. They're going to have post-concussive symptoms. But if you're treating them and they come in for like neck pain because of a concussion, and they're telling you, you know, like, I get so dizzy when I turn my head to the left, okay? And that's like, and it's a concussion patient, and you're like, okay, get dizzy and turn. They can also get positional vertigo because those crystals from the hit, from them hitting their head so hard, those crystals get jarred loose and they end up in their canals. So you can have a concussion patient with post-concussive symptoms, but also have positional vertigo. So that's a question you need to ask them if you're treating them and they're on your schedule and, you know, they're like talking about, man, when I turn my head, I really get dizzy. You know, okay, tell me, does that happen just when you do that motion, or is this something, you know, that happens when you lay down in bed? Get some more information from them because that PT that you're with may be able to clear them for BPPV. Medications, long-term use of antibiotics. I talked about the gentamicin. IV antibiotics, and then stress can also cause vertigo. Okay, so if you have a peripheral vestibular disorder, I'm gonna do it all my time, okay. If you have a peripheral vestibular disorder, that's gonna be basically brainstem into the ear, so that's your vestibular cochlear nerve and inside your ear. You can have unilateral hearing loss, ringing of the ears, nausea, and it bounces. The inner ear of the vestibular nerve up to the root in the brainstem is considered peripheral. These individuals will be holding onto the walls, maybe using an assistive device for gait unsteadiness. If it's a peripheral lesion, then they can still put one foot in front of the other, okay? They may not do it very well, but they can actually walk, whether it be crawl, walk, whatever, they can actually sense that motion. A central person cannot. They will have to have somebody carry them into the clinic. And I'll give you a good example of that when we talk about central. But nystagmus will be direction fixed, and it will be exacerbated when gazing in the direction of the fast component. So like I said, it always beats toward the excitation. And then that follows a law called Alexander's Law. Smooth pursuit and CK testing will be negative. Does anybody know what kind of tests those are, smooth pursuit and CK? Those are called ocular motor. So they're actually going to clear a patient of central pathology, okay?
This week in our case, our patient had a
pendulum horizontal
nystagmus. So what I want to talk about is the nystagmus reflex from the vestibular nerve and also...
Treating this with habituation exercises will decrease symptoms, and we'll go into that as well. All right, so if it's central, this is going to be something like MS, a stroke, a traumatic brain injury, Parkinson's. It includes the brain and its pathways. The patient may not even be aware of their symptoms. The nystagmus is going to be vertical and or torsional direction changing. So you're going to see it like this. If you see this, like, call a neurologist, okay? Because this is straight up, something's going on in their brain. Tumor, something, okay? Or if you have them look this way, and it beats this way, and you have them look that way, and it beats that way, call a neurologist, okay? We got to get you a scan, because there's something going on in the brain, okay? And it will not respond to habituation exercises. So these are the patients that we, unfortunately, can't help, okay? So, you know, until they get whatever it is resolved, whether it be a tumor or some kind of cerebellar injury or healed from a traumatic brain injury or stroke, then we just won't be able to help them that much recover from that.
So, when I was at my clinic, there was a guy who had he's in a motor vehicle accident, so he had a huge knot in his head, and he was having a certain tracking issues, and she was going to do like a neuro, the nurse was going to come and do a neuro exam with those,
yes,
main ones that they're looking for. Mm-hmm.
Yep, and it's an easy, quick screen. You watch what their eyes can do. If they are, if they can't follow the pin, or if they can't jump from one thing to the next and back again, so their tracking is bad. Like they have what we call saccades, where it's like they'll overshoot or they can't find the target, then that is a central sign. So these are the central tests that I do in my clinic. So I got a pen. How are you, Sam? I'll do my Bible too. Sit here and face out. For y'all, if you can't see, you can. So basically what I do is I watch what their eyes do while they're following a pen. So don't move your head, just follow the tip of my pen. So in a normal person, which I'm assuming is normal, my question there, he should be able to track that pen without taking his eyes off of it, okay? So if he's tracking the pen and I see his eyes jumping off of the pen or it's not smooth, then to me that's a central sign, okay? So I want you to look at my nose. Now look at my pen. Nose, pen, nose, pen. Good. So he should be able to jump between those two targets pretty spot on, okay? So if he's not able to jump, or if he jumps and he's like, his eyes go way out here and then come back to my pen, or here back to my pen, then I know that there's something going on centrally, okay, that I need to take a better look at. So they're right there. So gaze spontaneous is what you see when you're just looking at them. So if I was to look at you and I see nystagmus either you have something going on centrally or you're having a really cute unilateral hypofunction, bilateral hypofunction, peripheral dysfunction. Normally we don't see spontaneous nystagmus in just somebody that comes into our clinic and says that they're dizzy. We just don't see it because it's more than likely not central. The gaze is basically, I have them look at my pen and they just hold it there. So he's bouncing to the left, then I know that there's an issue, okay? I can come back to the middle and he could be fine, and we can come over here and he could be fine, okay? But I know he's bouncing towards the side of excitation. So to me, that means that his right side's gonna be involved, okay? He'll have a hypofunction over here because his left side's working well, but his right side's shut down, okay? And then the vestibular ocular reflex is what I was telling you. You should be able to hold the patient, hold it, and then focus on my nose. And then as you move, he should be able to track my nose, okay? If we're doing this and he's looking all over the place and he cannot stay focused on my nose, he has a VOR reflex dysfunction, okay? Thank you.
Now, is that the same thing as
So if you see a positive VOR reflex test, then you're going to do gaze stabilization exercises because their VOR is messed up. Their VOR is something's not right with it, and you have to retrain it. Okay. So abnormals if the patient can't maintain their fixation on that moving target without some gaze. So peripheral test is the head impulse test and the head shaking nystagmus test. The head shaking nystagmus test is very hard to see without goggles, okay? So I have these goggles, they look like scuba goggles. They actually, like in the video that you watched, you know how it was like magnified? You can actually put them in the dark and infrared see their eyes and what their eyes are doing. So some things you just have to, it's better to have the goggles, you can see better. So the head impulse test, So the head impulse test is going to test a peripheral dysfunction, okay? So all I'm going to do, I'll just stare at my nose, and I'm just going to move it side to side, okay? And then I want to just give him a quick jerk, like that, okay? He should be able to maintain fixation on my nose. If he doesn't, and more than likely it's one side, I have seen a bilateral. So when I go to the left, his eyes track late, or it jumps around until it gets to my nose. And then same thing when I go to the right, they can't maintain, and that's a bilateral hypofunction, okay? Most of the time in the clinic, you'll see like, boom, oh, wait, the eyes, they came late, you know? And I'm gonna show you a video of it. It's pretty neat to see, wow, you can definitely tell there's something going on there, okay? The head shaking nystagmus is, they close their eyes, I usually have the goggles on, just shake your head 20 times for me. Smile, yep, fast. Okay, and then stop and open your eyes. They should not have nystagmus. If they do, then there's some hypofunction somewhere. What this does is when you close your eyes, it builds the velocity storage system in your inner ear. And so if one side is not working like the other side, then the velocity storage is building up in the side you're exciting, and this one does nothing. So when you open up, he's gonna have nystagmus remember I said it beats to the excitatory side? So he's going to have nystagmus in that direction. Thank you very much. Let me show you these two videos real quick.
Welcome to our first webinar in 2016. Delay on that, not bad, but did you see that? So it's
like, it's almost like a delayed response of what the eyes are. Okay. And then that was the head impulse test. And then this is the head shaking. Compensates. Our vestibular system does an amazing job of compensating itself. So when one goes down, our body does what it's supposed to do and tries to heal by compensating. So the other one will work harder to make up for the loss that's there. So you can have a static compensation, which is just a natural, you know, this is what your body does. And then you can have a dynamic compensation, okay? So a dynamic is where we come in, okay? Because we're going to actually make them do things that help compensate for the loss that they have. So there's three things. Our goal is to restore normal gaze stability and postural control under static and dynamic conditions. You can use habituation, adaptation, or substitution, okay? So those are the three things that we will use. Okay, habituation is a long-term reduction of a response to noxious stimulus brought about by repeated exposure to provocative stimulus. Desensitization, that's all it is, okay? And you will see this in patients that are motion sensitive. So, for example, they tell you, okay, well, when I lay down on my side, I get dizzy, okay? You've cleared them, their test, you know, the PT is like, you know, they've diagnosed them with motion sensitivity disorder, okay? So what are you gonna do? You're going to habituate them. So you're going to make them lay down on their left side. You're going to do it repeatedly, okay? So you're desensitizing that system, all right? So that's habituation. And that's most commonly used with motion sensitivity. So there's the actual sheet. It's called the motion sensitivity test. You give it to them and you say, you know, does this position make you dizzy? Yes. How long does it last? Okay, and they rate it on a scale. And I have a copy of that if y'all want to see it. But then you go through, and that's how you make the plan of care. So the PT may go through and say, okay, turning her head to the left, bending over, and lying down on her left. Those three scored the highest, okay? Well, for the first treatment, you may not want to do the three that make her the sickest, okay, or make her feel the worst. You may pick something like, okay, well, bending over, putting her nose to her left makes her dizzy, but not as bad as bending over. Okay? So you may start off with that as homework. So you're going to give them bending over to the left knee, holding it there 30 seconds or until symptoms go away, coming back up. You may have them do that 5 to 10 times, like 3 to 5 times a day. Okay? And then you progress to the stuff that, you know, is hardest for them or causes the most symptoms. Okay? So that's habituation. Adaptation is what you will see most likely in the clinic. Those are exercises that you're gonna give the patients, okay? And that is changing a neural response to a stimulus that remains constant. Functional improvement in dynamic visual acuity from constant retinal slip error signals. So that's gonna be your VOR times one and VOR times two. All your gaze stabilization exercises are adaptation exercises, okay? Substitution is basically recruitment of an altered strategy to achieve functional function previously done by a now damaged natural system. So this is for patients that have more central and you really can't help them. You'll notice that they naturally compensate. They'll like, you know, instead of, if they know that they're gonna have a saccade when they turn their head a certain way, they may not turn their head so much. They may just keep it in their visual field where they don't get a retinal slip. Or they may blink during head rotation. So they're looking at something and they have to turn their head, so they may kind of blink to help get their eyes refocused. So that's just a substitution pattern. All right, so your treatment options. Adaptation exercises are what we mainly use. VOR times one, VOR times two, gaze shifting, remember targets, and then habituation is what I just showed you. Use the motion sensitivity quotient to figure out a good treatment for them. Okay, so we're gonna take a break. We're going to go actually through the lab. So y'all have a sheet that's called vestibular lab. Mm-hmm. and your therapist has diagnosed them with a unilateral hypofunction, okay? So a virus has attacked the inner ear or an infarct or something where one side's not working right. So there may be some things that she already tested her first day during her evaluation. She may have tested the modified CAT-SIP, just checking their balance, okay? Some of these are just functional tests we like to know to keep our patients safe and keep them free from falling, okay? She may have tested their single leg stance. Can they stand on one leg? Can they, how fast can they walk? Can they stand with one foot in front of the other in balance? And then she may have done an outcome measure like the functional gait assessment or the bird or the Tinetti or one of those to kind of assess their overall balance, okay? So what we're gonna do here is I'm gonna go through some of these exercises and some of these tests that you can kind of learn from. I think Tiffany said y'all have done the tug before. That is a great one to use. You can actually do a modified timed up and go, and that's where you add holding something in their hands and then a cognitive task like counting backwards starting at 30, and you can actually test their time from 10 feet, and see how much difference it is if you give them a cognitive task or a manual task of holding something. So that's the modified tug. So I want everybody to stand up. So what I'm going to show you is the modified CAT-SIP, okay? I actually have handouts of these in the back, so when we're done, if you're free to take the handouts that I use in my clinic to score the patients. But with the modified CAT-SIP, it's four criteria. You do feet together, eyes open, feet together, eyes closed, and then you put them on foam like an AirX pad and do feet together, eyes open, feet together, eyes closed. You actually time them for 30 seconds on each piece, okay? So their total, if they're normal and they can do it, is gonna be 120 out of 120 because you're doing the seconds, okay? They get three trials though. So, you know, if you get to the AirX and, you know, you have them, I usually have them cross over here so you can read if they, you know, are losing their balance. If they only get to 12 seconds, then do it again. If they only get to 15 seconds, then do it again. If they only make it to 17, that's your score, okay? So it would be 30, 30, 17, and then you would have to do the last test, and then you just kind of add up the numbers, all right? So for the modified CAT-SIP, you just basically have the patient, and I usually do this in an evaluation room where there's like a wall in front of them, so I'll have them face the wall, and then like I'm beside them and their chair's behind them, okay, so they feel safe. So you're just gonna have them stand and say, you know, put your feet together, hold your, cross your arms over your chest, and I want you to try to stand like that for 30 seconds. If you see them, you know, they do like this, or they let go of their arms, or they're, you know, really swaying out of the ordinary, then go ahead and stop the test because you want them to be safe, okay? So you'll do it, and then you'll have them do it with their eyes closed, and you'll try to do that for 30 seconds, and then you'll put them on the AirX, and you'll do all four of those, okay, and then tally it up. The next test you're going to do is standing on one leg. So I just have the patients stand on one leg, okay? Ages 65 and older should be able to do this more than 5 to 10 seconds, okay? So if they can't do it less than 5 seconds, then there's definitely a risk for falls, okay? And then the gait speed is measured. Have y'all done gait speed, like preferred gait speed? Y'all done that 20 feet where you walk and you give them a 5 foot start mark, start them as they cross the line, stop them as both feet in the line.
Yeah.
There's actually stats. So there's stats for you to you figure out the gait speed, 20 feet divided by the seconds of time that they went, okay? There's a chart that shows norms, reference values. So you can go ahead and say, okay, their gait speed was not in the norm. Okay, and that would be something that you would have to work on in the clinic. So if the therapist, if you're looking at their gait speed and, you know, for somebody in their 50s, you know, they couldn't, so that's my axis. So if you're looking in their 50s and it took them, they were only doing, let's just say, 2 feet per second. Per second is going to be slower, right, than 3 feet per second, right? So they're going to be way under the norm, all right? And then, same thing for women, there's a difference between men and women. So this is a good little chart. I can have Tiffany, or I can email this to you. That gives you the norms of, you know, when a therapist has done the preferred gait speed, you can look at that and say, oh, you know, we might need to add some gait stuff because they're really slow or they're really unsteady on their feet. All right, so how many of y'all have done the dynamic gait index? Okay. I don't really use the FGA, I use the dynamic gait index. To me, it's just a little bit easier. So, do what? It's quicker, and you know, they have to step over something higher and then walk them backwards in tandem. So, I just use the DGI. And so, basically, what you're going to do with that is have them walk. Now, when they walk and they turn their head left and right, this is going to have you do that, they're going to tell you how their VOR is, okay? So sometimes you don't even have to do the VOR test to know their VOR, okay? The dynamic visual acuity test, which I don't have on here, but I'll talk about it in a minute, is a test to test their function of their VOR. So you're going to have them stare at a Snellen chart, or there's these little easy charts you can print offline that I do in the clinic that you only stand 4 feet away, and you test their VOR. Okay? Let's do that. Anybody got a sticky note?
Okay. Never mind. I have one in my chart.
I have one in
the I use my chart.
So, if you don't have one, download a metronome app. So you want to do it, the VOR has to be fast movement of the head though. because if I slowed her down, so if I slowed her down, she's not going to get as much of a retinal slip. This is going to be easy for her, right? It's easier to read, right? Yeah. So if I increase it, then she's going to have to use that VOR really hard to find out what those letters are. Thank you very much. Now, so if a therapist did that, and you saw that in their evaluation, that they had a four-line difference, okay, you know that's not functional. What exercise would you give them to help?
Head turns.
Head turns? Okay, with what?
Sticky.
Yeah, so you would do gaze stabilization. So you, your therapist, let's just say she was horrible and she didn't leave any exercises for you to do, and you're seeing them on their second visit, okay? So there's like, you're like, I have nothing to go on. I see the trusting. And you can't get you. She's on vacation. You can't have access to her. Okay? So you're going to think, okay, well, you're looking at her eval. You're kind of reading, okay, what does she want me to do? All right, I see that she's got neuromuscular re-ed stuff on here. Okay, so I know she wants me to do some balance stuff. They couldn't stand on one leg. Their VOR was four line difference. So you're going to do gaze stabilization. Okay? And that is VOR times one. So you're basically going to have them stand 3 feet away. Okay? And you're going to have them stare at, like he said, a sticky note on the wall. You just write a letter, A. And you don't write it real big because you actually want them to work to look at it, okay? So you write it, I would probably say about, like, right here, that this size. And then you're just going to have them stare at it and turn their head. And sometimes I literally stick on the metronome and have them stand there and turn their head. And I time them for a minute. Now, if your patient is really symptomatic, they may tell you in 15 seconds, I can't focus on this thing. I feel sick. I feel horrible. Stop it. Don't make them go through the whole minute where they're going to puke on you, okay? So just stop the test, and then you're going to give them that as their homework, all right? So y'all can sit down. Yeah. It helps keep the speed high because you will find out a lot of elderly patients, you know, they'll start off pretty good, and then they'll kind of, oh, I can't see it. So they end up slowing down, and that's when it comes to focus. You're going to use smooth pursuit versus the VOR. So they say 120 is kind of what you set your metronome on, and that's one cycle. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and you're having them stay. And it just helps them, like, stay in beat for the minute. Helps me too if I'm actually doing it, because you'll find out people, you'll go to move their head and they're like they will not move, let you move their head. Like I'll try to do like the head thrust on them and they're like, I mean, they're just like muscle burning like crazy. And it's like, okay, just relax. And you start to move their head, then they're like, they'll stop. So when you're doing it, it's sometimes easier just to kind of, if you have something to distract them too, they'll kind of get into it and like let you move their head. You'll also find that some patients, when you give them instructions, which you've probably already seen this, they don't do it right the first time. So the metronome helps because a lot of times they'll do like this. You know, they're making big motions. Well, you can't keep your focus doing that. So you have to tell them, you know, it's just a small nod of your head. You know, and I still have patients. I'm like, can you see that? No. I'm like, well then, you know, we're not doing it right. We gotta stop and start all over. So with the metronome, they can only go in a small range to get back to hit that.
Do you think that's substituting in order not to go the full direction to one side?
Mm-hmm.
Would you consider that, okay, they failed it, we need to just readdress it?
I'll stop them and just say, make sure you're going both directions. It's just a lot of verbal feedback. Have them do it in front of a mirror so they can see themselves. Just actually doing the motion, just have them get used to it first, and then put the sticky note on there. Now, how would you progress somebody? So somebody can come in and they can do that for a minute. You know, they did it last time with a therapist for a minute, standing, and they didn't lose their balance, they didn't lose their focus, they had no symptoms. How would you progress it?
Put them on an Arix.
Yep, put them on an Arix. Okay, what else? How else? Don't speed it up. I would keep it around the same. Having what?
Walk.
Yeah, that's very hard.
Longer period of time.
Longer period of time. I don't know if I would do it a longer period of time. Usually a minute's good. If anybody can do it for a minute, they have normal VOR. function, but I would alter things like somatosensory. I would put them on the phone. I would make them stand tandem. I would put the sticky note on a busy background like a checkerboard where they're going to have something to try to distract them, so they really have to focus. I have patients that have had lots of kids, and this is like a 30-something-year-old lady. She came to me. She has tons of kids, homeschools. So I was like, you know what? Take your sticky note, turn the TV on, put the sticky note on the TV, stand on the other side of the couch while your kids are playing in the room, and do it. And like that was so hard for her because she had her children like running around. She was trying to distract her. Then she had the TV moving in the background trying to distract her. And so that was a really advanced. I mean, she was almost back to normal. So I was like, here, let's do a real challenge, okay? And then standing far away actually is going to make it harder because you have more in your visual field. All right. So those are ways that you can advance those exercises in the clinic if you do see those kinds of patients. Any questions so far?
Tiffany.
Sorry. So looking back at your vestibular lab, I just wrote some exercises that I do in the clinic. So, you know, if they're CAT-SIV, if it was 100 out of 120, and their worst was standing on phone with their eyes closed, guess what? That's what they need to do in the clinic, okay? So you're gonna do lots of standing on phone exercises. If one of my favorites is cone taps, so they have to use their visual field and focus, and so they're going to stand on one leg and you put three cones in front and they tap each cone, and they can easily do this at home with cans, so the cans of food on the floor, and so that's working on balance. Step over, so it's like stepping over something and stepping back over something, so they're getting single leg stance. Gait with pivots, gait with speed changes, so have them walk fast, have them walk slow, have them pivot and stop, that's part of the DGI. Lily pads, so what I do is I take yoga mats and I put ankle weights or little beanbag tosses or whatever. Like, I put those under the yoga mat, and I make them walk on that surface, so it's kind of like molehills. So they're actually having to kind of walk on an uneven surface in a controlled environment. Obstacle courses where they have to step over stuff, go weave in and out, go across. So all those things are going to be more balanced and gait exercises. Your gaze shifts and your remembered targets. If there's a patient that has a bilateral vestibular hypofunction, which basically means that both ears are shut down, you want to start with gaze shifts and remember targets. These are a little bit easier than VOR, okay? They may not be as symptomatic. So gaze shifting is basically you're going to have two cards, and you're going to look at one card, and then you're going to look at the other card with your eyes, and then you're going to turn your head. So you're not doing this, you know, back and forth. VOR2 is you're here, you're holding a card, and this is the hardest one, and you move your head and the arm in opposite directions. Okay, so that's VOR2. So they should be able to focus on their card, phone, whatever they have, and go back and forth at that 120, whatever. It's crazy. So gaze shifting is basically you have two cards, you look at one, look at the other with your eyes, then turn your head. Eyes, turn your head. Eyes, turn your head. Eyes, turn your head. Okay? Now, remember targets is basically like you have something in front of you, you close your eyes, you turn your head, and hopefully you're still looking at it when you open your eyes. Does that make sense? You're trying to remember your target, right? And those are kind of easier exercises that you can start off with if someone is really symptomatic. You will find out that these patients will tell you they're going to throw up, they're going to tell you that they're going to pass out, they're going to tell you they need to sit down. So depending on their feedback to you during their exercise program and their treatment, then that's how you kind of know, okay, I did too much today. Next time, I need to not do that. I need to maybe back off to gaze shifts or something like that. Okay?
Do you ever want them to feel like slight, not just comfortable, you know, like slight dizziness, just as a triangle?
Right, yes. My, what we learned at my course is I tell tell all my patients that their symptoms should not last more than 15 to 20 minutes after seeing me. Okay? So if they leave the clinic and they can barely walk and they feel like they have to be in the bed the rest of the day, then we did way too much. Okay? So it may just be something simple that you start off with and then kind of add to it as they come back in.
I'm going to just add on to that. So how long would you think if you had someone who really symptomatic come to the clinic? How long was the treatment session the first time? I don't feel like too much.
It's a lot of education. So I usually see them about 45 minutes. So I'll do a lot of education, a lot of rest breaks. So like in between exercises, I'll have them sit down, try to recuperate a little bit, and then do another set of exercises. And I really try to break it up. So I may do like a balance exercise and then do like a gaze stabilization exercise. And then go back and do a balance exercise just to give their VOR a rest break. Does that make sense? So, and then I'll give them like a sit down rest break, give them some water, you know. If they're really symptomatic, we may not get far at all, you know, because we may just do like gaze stabilization one time and they're about to throw up on me and I'm like, you know, what am I going to do with you? So I'll just give them a lot of education and a lot of stuff to do at home. Any other questions? Those are good questions.
You can go ahead. Who's first?
You keep saying modified cancer?
Yes.
That is short for?
The regular CATSIP is it's a clinical test of sensory integration and balance. That's what CTSIB. So modified is there's only the regular CATSIP, I think, has six components, and the modified just has four.
Okay. Is there also something called CATCOOLI or CATI? Another additional testing that's done or exercises for vestibular? I'm trying to remember the name of it. It's not coming to my head right now. Does that sound like where you're standing in the corner at a ball?
Oh, you're talking. Yes. Yes.
I can't remember it.
Cool. I think Cooley is. It is. We didn't learn about it in the course.
But it
does have very similar, it is basically a treatment plan developed by somebody, and it gives you the certain exercises to do standing in the corner, like feet together, feet apart, eyes closed, eyes open, yes. The modified CATSIP, the reason we do the modified version is because typically it's done on the Balance Master or the Neurocom. Have y'all seen those where it has the force plate? So you can't do the last two portions where, I mean, you could put a Chinese lantern, which they've done in the past, over their head. But we typically don't do that in clinic. We just do the modified version of it. Yeah. Any other questions? I know you have one. What's your question?
If we have a patient who we think has the central vestibular, and maybe PT just didn't specify, and what should we do?
Okay.
They have
so, like they came to you for vertigo, and the PT did the evaluation, and
didn't specify that it was central, but you can, like a lot of the symptoms, line up.
You would approach your PT again and ask them to double check some of the, if they would please double check some of the central testing again, because you feel like it could be something else that maybe could have been missed or overlooked or. And if that doesn't happen, then you call the referring doctor. I don't know. I mean, I have a really good relationship with my PTAs. And so, like, if they have a concern, they always come to me and ask me, hey, Jen, I saw this. What do you think? Or, hey, Jen, can you check this out again? It just doesn't feel right. Or so if you approach your PT and they are just, no, they're fine, whatever, and you're still seeing signs later in the treatment, I don't know, you might, if you have a clinical manager, you know, that's a clinician, maybe speak to them or, you know, ask the PT, can I call their referring physician just to make them aware? Most of the time, PTs are, I mean, the ones I work with are usually good about listening to the PTAs and saying, oh, yeah, they saw something, I hadn't seen this patient in a couple visits, yeah, let me double check, let me take a look. Yeah, if you're seeing some signs, I mean, they definitely, they haven't been scanned, you know, they definitely need to. So, any other questions? And I know some of y'all can't do the testing part, but I wanted you to know what it was. So when you look at the evaluation, you can say, oh, that was positive. I know what that means. Like, oh, you know, this is what we're going to have to work on, that kind of thing. So y'all are aware of it. My favorite. This, we're going to end with a bang right here. All right. So how many of y'all have seen BPPV patients? What, how do they typically present? Like, what is the first thing they usually say when they come into the clinic?
Want to get out of bed.
They tell you a position of, yeah, they tell you, it doesn't last very long. It goes away typically if I just sit there for a minute, right? Or they'll say, boy, when I roll over in bed, I sure do get the spins. You know, they'll give you all of that information, okay? This is the easiest fix. So out of all the vertigo patients you want to see this one. Because normally, if the PT is doing the evaluation, they'll treat them that day, and really, they don't come back to the clinic. I just had two that I treated last week. I called them today. I said, how are you doing? Do you still have any of the dizziness? And one of them is like, I am doing so good. I've not had one spell. And the other one's like, yeah, I've got a little bit of some. And I said, well, if it, you know, I gave her exercise to do. I said, well, if it's still occurring later this week, call me, and I'll get you back in, and we'll do another procedure, maneuver. So typically 94% of those are located in that posterior canal, okay, in the back. You've seen this nystagmus is usually torsional. So that video I showed you where the eye was jumping up and turning, that was BPPV, okay, and of the posterior canal. And that's caused when those little crystals get out of that utricle or and they float around in those canals and hit that cupola and deflect it. Our treatment is 90% effective. We use the Dix-Hall pipe to actually test for it. We do the sideline test, and we do a roll test for the horizontal canal. Who wants to be a volunteer?
Ashley.
No, I'm saying that she doesn't.
I don't want to make her dizzy.
No, I was kidding.
Yeah, I don't want to. I already know you got some.
Oh, I'm curtain.
Okay. So, I'm going to do the Dix-Hall pipe, so I'm going to have you sit right here facing that way with your legs up.
Jennifer, have you noticed, depending on where you were taught in the U.S., it's either Dix-Hall pipe or Hall pipe's Dick? Have you noticed that?
I mean, in my class, I learned it Dix-Hall pipe.
Yeah, that's how I learned it.
Yeah, but no, I haven't noticed that. And there was some Australians in our like course with us, and they never said anything to us. All right, slide back a little bit more. So with the Dix-Hall pipe, all you're going to test is for positional vertigo. Okay, so this is basically the posterior canal and the anterior canal. All right. So if I lay her back, okay?
No.
I can't see your face. If I lay her back and her eyes upbeat and turn, that's the posterior canal. If I lay her back and they downbeat and turn, that's the anterior canal. Okay. So the hardest part is telling the patient, keep your eyes open for me. You might feel dizzy, but please keep your eyes open because you need to look at the direction of the nystagmus, okay? So all I'm going to do is I'll have you cross your arms over your chest. Have you ever done this before or seen it before? Okay. So I rotate their head to the non-affected side first. So let's just say her left, she rolls to the left or turns to the left. So I would say that would be her positive side or symptoms and then that symptomatic side. So I'm going to turn your head to the right about 45 degrees because you're young and you have that much rotation. If they're older, they may not have that much, so just go as much as you can, okay? And then on the count of three, I'm just going to lay you back really quick, okay? And you just try to keep your eyes open and not get dizzy, okay? So, one, two, three, we come back. And so all I'm doing is watching her eyes. Oh, no, I didn't really get dizzy. I don't really see anything. We sit back up, okay? Now, watch them when you sit back up because they'll get a rebound dizziness. So they may, woo! So you watch their eyes when they come back up too. So then let's do the left side. All right. We'll go down real fast. Ready? One, two, three. And you extend them just a little bit because gravity helps that swoosh, that indolymph, okay? For those. And boy, woo, her eyes are going up and turning, okay? It lasts 10 seconds, okay? That is canalithiasis, all right? If I laid her here and it lasted a minute, that's going to be cupulolithiasis. There's actually crystals that are stuck to that little cupola, that little bubble thing I was showing you. They actually get stuck there, and so the endolymph is moving, but the crystals aren't moving anywhere. They're just stuck, and they're deflecting that cupola, and it's not. So they're going to have, like, nystagmus longer than 30 seconds to a minute, okay? So it goes away. So she's positive. So stay here and watch your chin. All right, so the treatment. Now, y'all can do this if you have a PT that shares in their joy and love of vestibular rehab. So I have my PTAs know how to do this. Not that they would ever have to do it, but you know, if a patient comes in and I'm not there and they're having these symptoms and I've already diagnosed them with it, then they at least know how to follow up with what I've been doing. Okay? So this, she's positive to the left, and this is called the Epley. It's now been renamed the cantilever repositioning maneuver. I don't know why, but they call it the CRM now. So I'm going to have her turn her head to the right, okay? She doesn't get symptoms, but all you're doing is basically moving the crystals back out of the canal. If she does get symptoms, I wait till they're gone and count 30 seconds. So I usually say 30 seconds to a minute in each position. Okay, now you're going to roll on your right side, so you're going to be looking down. So then she's going to be looking down. Once again, gravity helps me. It moves the endolymph around. We stay here. She's good. Okay, do what? It is, yeah, Kasani. That's what you're talking about. I think that's actually a different maneuver. So there's a bunch of them. But this is the one most commonly used for the posterior canal. All right. And then sit up. Still looking to your right.
That
I just treated her affected side.
Okay.
So we started here. She was looking left. Boom. That's the Dix Hall pipe. Boom. She's symptomatic. All right. Then I turn her to the right.
Okay.
Yeah, so I'm swooshing the crystals out of that area. So if she was, she had a positive Dix Hall pipe, it's just easier for me to go ahead and treat it while she's already down in that position. Otherwise, I sit her back up, then I have to get her back down in that same position looking to the left. So that's the, thank you very much, that's the cantilever repositioning maneuver. The roll test is for horizontal, and that's basically, it's so simple, it's crazy. So you lay them like this, and you just roll their head to the side, and that's straight up horizontal canal, and then you roll them to the other side. If they have nystagmus, that beats down, because it'll be straight horizontal, so there won't be no torsional component to that. But if they have, if it beats down to the ground, that's canalithiasis. If it beats up with a cup, that's cupulolithiasis. That's how I remember it. All right, so there's a picture of the Epley. Test the uninvolved ear first. Can cause nausea and vomiting. And then these are the Brandt Dahroff exercises. So these are exercises you're going to give your patients that may have just a little bit, like they come in and they're like, Jennifer treated me with that thing where she flipped me around all over the place. She's like, I feel a lot better, but I still have a little bit. So if you don't feel comfortable doing the Epley again to them, or I'm not there, the PT is not there to ask them a question, you can give them the Brandt Dahroff, which is a habituation exercise, kind of like the motion sensitivity, and you have them do this. So you have them turn their head and then lay down, and then they stay there until their symptoms go away plus 30 seconds. Have them turn their head and lay down to the opposite side. And that you do that like 5 to 10 times. So you're just trying to swoosh the crystals out of the semicircular canals. Okay, so last little thing that I'll include, and then we'll do some question time real quick. What do I do if all testing is negative? So if the therapist has ruled out central, they've ruled out peripheral, they've ruled out positional vertigo, and like they still have dizziness, like where is that coming? Okay, so one thing that I actually just diagnosed last week is cervical, okay? You can get suboccipital impingement, which can cause dizziness, okay? So how are you going to treat these? You're going to look for postural deformities. So it's usually a person that's like this, and they're forward here, usually older ladies, and they got their chin way out, and basically they're sitting in extension. Can you y'all see that? Okay, so there's like no space right here. Okay, so they're getting suboccipital impingement of the nerves that are in these areas. Okay, you're going to look for trigger points. You're going to look for any swelling that could be there, tumor, anything like that, that may be like physically on the outside. Any kind of fascial restrictions, or if you have x-rays, or if they've had knee pain, or they told you that, you look for those bony malalignments. Okay? So here's some trigger points. You know, some that can cause over the eye issues, some that can cause the dizziness that can kind of come with that. Referred pain may also be from nerve compromise, neurovascular compromise, posterior vertebral joint irritation with restrictions. The C1 and C2 nerves combine to form the greater occipital nerve, and they're at the with the occipital basilar artery. They supply the region up to the vertex. So, and then also when C3 is irritated, that's the sensory dermatome is along the jaw. So they may even talk about TMJ or sensation issues here coming up through the back. So look for things like that when you're treating patients with neck pain, and if they say that they're dizzy, can you relate that to a postural deformity or a suboccipital impingement? And then here's how you treat those defunctions. This one too, you can do Mulligan Moebs, which y'all can't do cervical Moebs, so excuse my Moebs. But you can use muscle energy techniques, you can use trigger point releases, you can use manual therapy, you can do mechanical traction, manual traction, ultrasound, E-stim, Ionto. Sometimes it's been proven, there's a little bit of research out there, to use just like the white distilled vinegar with an Ionto patch for the greater occipital nerve inflammation. So they put it way up high here, and that helps decrease the inflammation in that nerve and relieve some of their symptoms of pain. There's just some references. Most of it came from this big old book up here from my course. So if y'all have any information or need any information, let me know. In the back, there's the modified CATSIB, the TUG, the dynamic gait index, and the functional gait assessment, copies of those tests for you to use in clinic if you need those. Does anybody have any questions? I know a lot of that was a lot of stuff to cover. So hopefully when you go back out in clinic, your ears will perk up and you hear somebody say that they're dizzy. And then definitely try to get with their treating PT or PT that did their eval, and you know, start to ask those questions. Hey, when do you get this dizziness? Hey, what's it like? How long does it last? Is it positioned? And start to kind of get those questions going and converse with your PT on how you can help this patient better. One thing that I want to mention to y'all in marketing to different doctors and things in the area. A lot of patients come in and the first thing that they say to me is people think I'm crazy. Like, I have this dizziness and I don't know, I can't walk straight, and you know, I tell my family and they just think I'm crazy, and the doctor just says it's because I'm getting old. And that is not an excuse for that to happen. There is a reason that they're dizzy and there is a reason that they have vertigo. So our job is to find out why and to fix it. And there's some things like we can't fix, like the central dysfunctions, but if we can make somebody aware of that going on, I mean, that's huge for them. That's life-saving for them, whether it be a tumor, cancer, whatever. The other thing is there are a lot of doctors that say, well, you're just getting old, and they tell the patients that, and the patients never come in for treatment because they just assume that they're old and they have to live with it. So a lot of education has to be done to your referral sources and to, like, patients in your community or people you meet in your community. Like, I met a lady in the grocery store the other day. I was talking about being dizzy. I'm like, you are? Oh, well, I can fix you. And she's looking at me like, you can do what? And I'm like, yeah, come see me. I'm like, I treat patients with dizziness all the time. Oh, you can fix that? I'm like, yeah, there's a reason why you're dizzy. Let's find out why. You know, and most of the time, my patients, like right now, if you look at my functional outcome scores that we do on a national day-to-day, we have a database that we use called Photo. Most of my patients are 90% to 100% better once they leave me. So it is something that we can treat and help patients with, and they don't have to live their life feeling like they're going to fall on the floor every time they get up and walk or turn over in bed. So thank y'all for having me. I really appreciate it. Tiffany has my email address. Feel free to email me anytime. If you're in the clinic and you see a patient, you're just like, let me just ask her about this. Feel free to email me because I love question and answer stuff.
Okay.
I'm done.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You guys have about a 10-minute break.